I think to have today the Security Council with five countries which have permanent veto, and then you go to see, and the Security Council is supposed to be responsible for the security of the world, and you found out that the five Security Council countries produce and export 82% of the world weapons, well, I think we need to do some reform.
It's The Real News. I'm Lynn Fries. And that was a clip from The Real News exclusive footage of Roberto Savio at a UN library talk on multilateralism.
Today's show features clips of that talk as Savio presents his thoughts on how the world went from multilateralism to the old policy of power. What's now the library, the UN Geneva, was home originally to the League of Nations, created in 1919 after World War I by the Treaty of Versailles. The League of Nations was forerunner to the United Nations, created in 1945 after World War II. Having failed to prevent World War II, the League of Nations was disbanded. War reparations under the terms of the Treaty of Versailles had imposed an unbearable debt burden on Germany after World War I, and the rest is history, with the rise of nationalism and Hitler. Today's featured UN Library Talk is part of a commemoration taking place throughout 2019, marking the 100-year centenary of multilateralism in Geneva. We now go to featured clips of Roberto Savio's UN Library Talk. We limit focus to the period from 1981 and into the present, while noting that in this UN talk and extensive writings, Roberto Savio covers the full sweep of multilateralism. He's co-founder of Interpress Service News Agency, an IPS President Emeritus and Chairman, and also publisher of Other News. The brief intro to Savio's commentary is drawn from his extensive published work and comments. It's hardly a contested point that with the creation of the United Nations in 1945 and the subsequent post-war world order, the centrality and supremacy of the United States, reinforced by U.S. military might, was assured. The United Nations was created with a Security Council where the U.S. could veto any resolution. The World Bank and IMF were created with the U.S. dollar as the world's currency. The creation of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, as a response to any threat from the then Soviet Union, was an entirely U.S. affair. After the Second World War, there was global consensus about the need to prevent a repetition of the horror experienced between 1939 and 1945, and the first phase of U.S. policy embraced this consensus and was based on multilateralism, international cooperation, and respect for international law. The UN was the forum where almost all nations met. The Cold War that ensued led to the creation of an association of young, newly independent countries, the non-aligned nations, which became a buffer zone between the East and West. The global gap between the North and South became the most important issue of international relations. In 1974, the UN General Assembly adopted a resolution on the establishment of a new international economic order and a charter on the economic rights and duties of states. In 1981, in Cancun, Mexico, a summit to adopt a global action plan was held with the most influential heads of state, meeting in what was officially known as the International Meeting on Cooperation and Development. Participants at the Cancun summit, from the then President of France, François Mitterrand, to Indian Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, from Tanzanian President Julius Nyerere, to Canada's Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau, shared certain values of social justice, solidarity, and respect for international law, as well as the conviction that strong societies were the basis for democracy. The exception being U.S. President Ronald Reagan, who with British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher stopped the plan dead in its tracks. Roberto Savio wrote, quote, "I was there and saw how, to my dismay, the world went from multilateralism to the old policy of power in just 2 days," end quote. Savio explains the U.S. had become rich because of trade, and Reagan's slogan was trade, not aid. A Reagan-Thatcher alliance was based on making markets and the free movement of capital the basis for international relations. Since 1981, the United Nations has been in a long period of decline. The Group of Seven has become the Group of 20, and the World Economic Forum in Davos, a more important forum than the United Nations General Assembly. In the book, Remembering Boutros-Boutros-Ghali, a tribute to the former UN Secretary General, Savio wrote, quote, "With him, we lived through what unfortunately now looks as the last great moment in the United Nations and of international law as the basis for cooperation and action." Boutros-Boutros-Ghali spoke of trends in global governance by which big powers were marginalizing the United Nations and the fact that the two main engines of globalization, finance and trade, were already running outside the organization. He was the only Secretary General in the history of the United Nations to be denied a second mandate. When Boutros-Boutros-Ghali was vetoed by the U.S. for a second U.N. term, he told Savio, quote, "Americans do not want you to say yes. They want you to say yes, sir," end quote.
From 81, more or less, we were able to keep some validity in international cooperation. Personally, I think because of the Cold War, which obliged each one of the two blocs to be accountable, to be efficient, to prove that his theories were valid. So there was a fight not only of power, but also vision. Now, then a hurricane came over. In 1989, the Berlin Wall fell. And everybody said, well, now there is no more communism. There are people who wrote books. That is the end of history. Because now there is no need any longer of history. We are going to have all the same. In a conference in Milan, the Director General of WTO told, now is the time of unifying the world. We have no more Cold War, so we can all go using capitalism at the best of its possibilities. We are not going to have any longer frontiers. We are going to have only one currency, and there will be no more war in the world. All that is in the record. Then, contemporary to this Berlin Wall affair, there was another one going on, which was the Washington Consensus, in which the financial institution of international relevance, the World Bank, International Monetary Fund, the American Treasury, came up with an agenda on how to run the world on the principle of the best possibility of capitalism, some of which were the state should not meddle in society. Everything which can be privatized must be privatized because it will work better. And a number of other issues from this syllogism, which made that social investment were not productive. Education, research, school, health were not productive. Everything which could be globalized was globalized. Trade, finance, what was left to the countries were only issues which were not really producing resources in the short term of the sense. While this went on, the Washington Consensus, we had another moment which was very negative, which was the abolition of the Glass-Steagall law, which divided Bank of Investment and Bank of Deposit. And suddenly, all the enormous quantity of resources, financial resources, which were in the Bank of Deposit, went all to Bank of Investment. The result is that today, if somebody of you has $989 billion, you can go and buy all services good of that day. In the same day, financial transactions are $40 trillion. In other words, there are $40 of financial transaction for every dollar produced by men in the world. And that was created by that abolition of this Glass-Steagall law, which was from 1933. On top of this, we have a political theory, which is, as nobody can stop globalization, let us ride it, let us drive it. That was Tony Blair, who invented the third way, which effectively create a total separation between the social classes and the social democrat. So we have been assisting to a dismantling from the creation of the United Nations to the moment in which Reagan arrives and says, I'm not interested in international democracy. And this has been developing to the point in which we reached the crisis of 2008. The financial crisis. All historians agree the two engines of history are greed and fear. Now, we arrive at that crisis with a long education of greed, because the value of globalization were to become rich. The value of development were different. You enter in a development process, and when you come out, you are more than you were. The process of globalization is when you come out, you will have more money than you had. Two entirely different paradigms. The result, we have been educating for three decades people to the idea of greed, competition, money, success, terms like solidarity, social justice, went out from the political debate. They don't exist any longer. And then, finally, to conclude, we arrive to the moment in which United States follow its logic and say, we don't want to be in a straitjacket, but we want to win. We want to compete. And goes around saying, everybody, compete. Make your own interest. Let us split everybody in interest. And the fear, which came after, has brought the escape goal of immigrants, the number of issues for which people now have fear. Young people are unemployed. There is not much participation in politics. Political parties were discredited. New political forces are coming up, which are not with the program of construction, but of denunciation of what does not work, which is much. But I don't think that using xenophobia, populism, and nationalism is going to solve those problems. I think it's going to worsen them. And we can see, because as soon as one of these parties took power in Italy, it is an admitted disaster. Because taken, all these anti-system parties start from realities which exist. But they do not have the answer. Brexit is not an answer. Because whatever will happen, England will be reduced in its economic development, in its international strength, and will become just a country. In a period in which globalization has brought up new players, from China to India to the middle countries. Etiologists, the people who study men as part of human race, Conrad Lorenz, wrote something fundamental. Man is the only member of the animal family who does not learn from mistakes. All animals learn, men does not learn. We are coming back to the debate of values, principles, ideas of the 30s. We are going to compete all against us. We're going to win. How this is going to be done? We are abolishing the nuclear treaty. We are ignoring climate change. We are not addressing one of the existential issues that we have in face. And in the 30s, you had the same debate. So we are going back to a period in which we all know what happened, how many million people died, and it is going on. And I think that once we stop thinking that our past is our future, as now many people think, Great Britain, the Emperor of the Sea, go back to this. In Italy, people are talking of the time that Mussolini trains were on time. I mean, all this folklore coming up from the past and trying to think that the past is our future. I think multilateralism will come back with strong, because you cannot have a balance of big powers fighting each other without going back to some kind of international mechanism. We have now a situation which is abnormal because we have China, India, United States, Europe, which are four big players, but a lot of other players coming up which cannot have the same size, but they're very important. You cannot have an international system without some kind of agreement, unless you want to have tension and possibly wars. So I'm convinced that multilateralism will go back, probably with some reform from the prison system. I think to have today the Security Council with five countries which have permanent veto, and then you go to see, and the Security Council is supposed to be responsible for the security of the world. And you found out that the five Security Council countries produce and export 82% of the world weapons. Well, I think we need to do some reform in international institutions. Thank you.